The Norfolk City Council is now in session. Please stand for a moment of silence. Remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Mr. Clerk, please call the roll.
Mrs. Doyle?
Here.
Mrs. Johnson?
Here.
Mrs. McClellan?
Here.
Mr. Page?
Here.
Ms. Royster?
Here.
Mr. Smigel?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
Dr. Alexander?
Here. The motion is to dispense with the reading the minutes of our previous meeting.
Yes, sir. Those meetings are May 9th and June 6th, 2023, May 23rd, June 7th, and June 13th. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, please read the resolution certifying the closed meeting.
I have a resolution certifying a closed meeting of the Council of the City of Norfolk in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act. Adopt the resolution. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Good evening and welcome to the Norfolk City Council Chamber. Tonight, we will first take up public hearings, then the consent agenda, which will be voted on in a block. If any member of the public or the council wishes to discuss an item, it will be removed from the consent agenda and considered separately. Following the consent agenda, we'll take up regular agenda items in order as they appear on the docket. To address the council on an agenda item or new business, you should register to speak prior to 3 p.m. with the clerk. When your name is called, please come to the podium, state your name and your address, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Mr. Clerk, before we begin, can you please read the rules governing tonight's meeting?
Certainly. City Council rules permit each speaker 3 minutes to speak on an item. As you approach the council, you'll notice a timer on the lectern. At the beginning of your 3 minutes, a green light will activate. 2.5 minutes into your remarks, you will notice a yellow light. This indicates that you have 30 seconds to finish your comments. At the end of 3 minutes, you will see a red light and hear a beep. We ask that you conclude your comments at that time. While speakers have an opportunity to address council on docket matters, all comments should be made in a manner that respects the seriousness of the forum and should not be made in a profane, disruptive, sarcastic, or demeaning fashion. All remarks shall be directed to the City Council as a body, rather than any one particular member of City Council, staff, or the audience. Comments on an agenda item should be germane to that item. A speaker who fails to comply with the basic rules of decorum will be deemed out of order and not allowed to conclude his or her comments.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. PH 1.
Public hearing 1 scheduled this day pursuant to state law to hear comments approving the conveyance by the city of the property known as 601 through 609 West 35th Street to the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority.
Thank you, Mr. Rodney Jordan.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Rodney Jordan in the 300 block of West 36th Street. I've had the honor and privilege over the years to serve in many capacities, both in the Park Place community and the larger Norfolk community. I'm here today in opposition to this conveyance. It was probably the 1998-1999 when the businesses along 35th Street and the community worked with the Housing Authority then at the time to have that parking lot built. It was intended to serve as a public use for all the businesses along the corridor. 35th Street is blocked with residential on both sides of the commercial corridor. So that parking lot has served in many ways, allowing many businesses to be able to have the parking space that they need in order to conduct business. We recruited Croker Spot to 35th Street as a catalytic project. And as a neighborhood and as a city, we rolled out the red carpet and the welcome mat for that purpose. And we were pleased with the success that Croker Spot was having. And we found ways to collaborate and work together as a community with that parking lot and with the success we were seeing there. We didn't recruit. Our intent was not to recruit low-income housing tax credit development in Park Place. Our intention was to recruit Croker Spot as a catalytic project. Now that the city has made an investment in the boxing center, in a recent meeting it was discussed about the boxing center needing parking, and so they're having considerations of doing parking along 35th Street next to the in between the Masjid and the boxing center. So I think really the city needs to, I would recommend that the city come back and really work with the community and look at the big picture, because I think we're going to have challenges with the parking if we proceed down this path and turn the parking lot over for this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Jay Boone. Okay. Those were the rest of the speakers are proponents, and if you wish to speak, you certainly can speak, but you're winning. Kevin Hansen, Ishmael Shaleen, Nathaniel Butler, Latif Rashid, and Columbus Grant. Do you wish to speak? You do wish to speak?
Yes.
You're winning, sir.
Yeah. I don't think he understands.
You're winning, sir.
No, I'm not wishing.
All right. Mr. Clerk, call the roll.
I have an ordinance approving the conveyance by the city of the property known as 601 through 609 West 35th Street to the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
No.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Nay.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
Motion passed.
All right, page two.
Public hearing two scheduled this day pursuant to state law to hear comments approving a lease agreement with TWP, the Youth Movement for the lease of city owned property located at 700 East Olney Road, known as the Vivian C. Mason Arts and Technology Center.
Jay Boone. Mr. Clerk.
I have an ordinance approving a lease agreement with TWP, the Youth Movement, for the lease of city owned property located at 700 East Olney Road, known as the Vivian C. Mason Arts and Technology Center. Dispense with the charter requirement for reordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. Mr. Clerk, the consent agenda will be considered a block except for C1.
Approve the consent agenda and dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinances twice and adopt with the effective date, with the exception of C1. Ms. Doyle?
Aye.
Ms. Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
C1 is an ordinance approving a right of entry permitting Hope Foundation, Inc. to go upon and use city-owned property located at 901 Church Street.
Cole McGill.
Hi, thank you for hearing me today. I'm Nicole McGill, 400 East Freemason Street. I'm talking today as advocate for people that live with severe mental disabilities. And my advocacy name is Voice of the Voiceless Parents, because most of them are either in institutions or being oppressed. I would like to state that I'm for this. However, I really think that we need to start also making sure that these other nonprofits are doing inclusion for people that live with severe mental illness. And I'm talking about people that live with schizophrenia, general anxiety disorder, bipolar, to the severe end of the spectrum. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk?
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk? R1.
R1 is an ordinance accepting the bid submitted by Community Power Group, LLC, for solar facility site lease agreements with a term of approximately 20 years, with the options to renew for 3 additional 5-year periods in order to operate and maintain a solar energy and storage facility at 2400 Berkeley Avenue Extended.
Yes, okay. Mike Borkowski, followed by Nicole McGill. Mr. Borkowski, would you?
Hi, my name is Mike Borkowski with Community Power Group, located at 5636 Connecticut Avenue in Washington, D.C. First, I want to thank the members of the council, staff, as well as members of the community for their consideration of this project and all it has to offer. We've spent a fair bit of time getting to know members of the local community, and I got to tell you, they are a really great group of people that care tremendously about everything that happens. And we've really enjoyed getting to know them, as well as supporting some of their local activities, and look forward to continuing that support into the future. And so I just wanted to say thank you very much for considering this proposal in front of you, and that I stand ready to answer any questions that you might have.
Thank you so much. Lawrence Brown? Lawrence is not here? Okay. Let's go with Nicole McGill, followed by Alton Robinson.
Hi, once again. I actually am for the solar energy system. However, some of the details was left out of the notes that were given for me to read. And I do have a concern with the general number that was thrown out there at the last meeting of 10% savings. I'm one of the advocates that was putting awareness in the educational material about the benefits of the solar energy system, and how it will benefit the savings. So 10%, I think, is a really low number. That's the only concern that I have about this proposal. One of the competitive companies was offering our residents 25%. So I think somewhere between 10 to 25% should be what we go for. I think 10% is too low. And I do really appreciate the activities and the presence of this company in our community. Thank you for hearing me out.
Thank you. Alton Robinson.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
My name is Alton Robinson. I'm not opposing this project. I've just been on board from the beginning, and I've seen the changes, and apparently some deals have been made, and the community seems to be okay with it, from my understanding. So I just want to thank you all for what you're doing here as far as moving the project forward, even though I can't really think of any words that I can say, because I've been coming down here for years. You guys are new on council. A lot of faces you all are new, but not to me, but to the council. And I cannot think of a single word that I can say that I could believe that will persuade you in any decisions that you've already made. So I just want to say thank you all. And I hope that one day I would be able to say a single word that would be able to change your minds. But I'm not against this project. So I just want to say that. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Chief Boone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So yes, I had been following the
all the talks and the communications with the solar panel company that we had. I wasn't able to make the last planning committee meeting, but there are a lot of the issues that we had as far as the things that were guaranteed to the community. And so even looking at the paperwork from tonight, I think if the gentleman or the company can speak to the things that the citizens were guaranteed outside of the percentages, but we're talking about the STEM program, or we're talking about the guaranteed employment, or any of those other things that we as citizens had brought in concerns to them, and they said that, oh, city council would vote on it after the fact. Like, can we have that laid out as well before we agree to something? Because everything for the city is in there, everything for the company is in there, but the guarantees that you guys are promising us aren't really aligned there. And 20 years is a long time to say that you guys are going to be in a position to be able to guarantee that that happens. And so we just want to make sure that on our end that we have that, whatever we've agreed to, because I think we can all say that this is something that's valuable and needed, but if we're getting it or bringing it into the communities because they are disadvantaged and there's percentages and tax credits and all that stuff, then the equity part of it needs to be laid out for the communities that are affected by those types of things as well. So thank you.
Mr. Bull.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
I'm going to vote aye. I commend the community for coming together and working to make sure that the things were included that were important to the community. So I'm going to encourage the company to keep your word and continue to work with the South Side. This was a great process, and I was proud to be a part of it. My vote is aye.
Ms. Royster?
Yes, I also wanted to thank the community as well as thank Community Power Group for showing up and really stepping up last month, or was it earlier this month, Impact Virginia Incorporated, which is headed by Michelle Harrison and Maceo. I think I just saw him walk in. They did a really impactful event over in the former Save-A-Lot parking lot, and the way that you all supported that community grassroots organization was very admirable. I think they were able to service over 1,000 people in that community that day. And when you talk about Community Power Group, your first name is Community. So I want to thank you for stepping up and connecting with grassroots community members. And I hope that that work and that support of the persons who care, live in Norfolk continues, not just for one event, but continuously through your relationship. I vote aye.
Mr. Smigel.
I wasn't part of the conversations, but I hope that somebody had mentioned that Southside STEM Academy is right there, and this is a great opportunity for lessons for young folks to learn about solar energy and that technology, and that the company will be partnering with the school. Yep. So did that come up?
That definitely came up. Okay. And I think it was our last meeting. That was actually something that they proposed as wanting to assist, especially with the robotics program.
Yes.
Obviously, they got to connect with our partners over at NPS, and I hope the community continues to support those efforts for our youth as well.
Good. Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R2.
R2 is an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize the operation of a solar energy collection facility, large scale, on property located at 2400 Berkeley Avenue Extended.
Mr. Bukowski, would you like to speak again, sir?
Thank you, members, again for considering this. I just wanted to iterate that this is directly connected to that other project and just the operating of it. And I do want to express a lot of gratitude for the community. It truly is an amazing group and how they reached out to us and were really able to demonstrate what a great community it is. So thank you.
Mr. Brown, Lawrence Brown, did he ever come in? Lawrence Brown. If not, Nicole McGill.
Thank you. As chairperson of the Wind Center, which is also a grassroots nonprofit, I'm glad to hear that Community Power Group and their affiliates were actually eco-netting before they started networking and forming deals. That is a step before networking is eco-netting. And that is, for people that don't know the term, it's a business term for when a business or a representative of a business puts back into the community before they're able to start profiting. Like I said, it's a step before networking. It's showing to the community, the natives that already live there, that they're not there to kill them off or make them leave. They actually want to include them. in their operations and growing with them and their families to come. So I'm thankful for Ms. Royster announcing how they contributed and how they did an impact in that area. Once again, I would like to speak and advocate for my peers and that the inclusion of people with severe disabilities is also included with this. My peers are able and capable, just like I am. We just learn differently. So the opportunities to learn robotics, as well as the solar energy and be able to contribute and work, also get man hours, which are basically limited, of course. They like to say ballpark is 15 hours. Some of us work less than that, even 4 hours a week. It's still be able to do something that's called wellness work. So thank you so much.
Mr. Bold.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
R3. R3 is an ordinance amending and reordaining ordinance number 49183 so as to amend the title and body of the ordinance to include an additional parcel located on the north side of East Princess Anne Road, tax account number 0000225. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R4.
R4 is an ordinance to cancel the regular city council meeting scheduled on July 18, 2023. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R5.
R5 is an ordinance amending the FY 2023 Annual Appropriations Ordinance number 48751 so as to accept, appropriate, and authorize the expenditure of donated funds up to the sum of $5,000 from the Friends of the Norfolk Public Libraries for the purpose of supporting the Slover Library's 2023 Summer Reading Program.
Ms. Nicole McGill.
I would like to thank wholeheartedly to the Friends of the Norfolk Public Libraries who actually donated these funds. The Norfolk Public Libraries is one of our major supporters in the community, as well as even customizing and working with us to insert workshops that might not be already on part of the original schedule, so that my peers can and myself can participate, as well as our children who may also have special needs or may not, but we may have special needs, so they will custom workshops and work with us one-on-one with our children and things of that nature. So thank you so very much from the Wynn Center and my peers.
Mr. Bull.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R6.
R6 is an ordinance amending the FY 2023 Annual Appropriations Ordinance number 48751 so as to accept, appropriate, and authorize the expenditure of grant funds up to the sum of $20,606.35 from the Virginia Marine Resources Commission for the purpose of reimbursing the city for the environmental containment removal and disposal of a sunken 29-foot coastal cruiser at the Willoughby Bay boat ramp. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas. Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R7.
R7 is an ordinance amending the FY 2023 Annual Appropriations Ordinance number 48751 so as to accept, appropriate, and authorize the expenditure of grant funds up to the sum of $50,000 from the Virginia Economic Development Partnership, Virginia Resources Authority, and Department of Environmental Quality through the Virginia Brownfields Restoration and Economic Redevelopment Assistance Fund Program, and previously appropriated local matching funds in the amount of $5,520,000 for the project at 1401 and 1445 Maltby Avenue.
Ms. McGill, Nicole McGill.
Thank you. I was looking over the notes, and I have a quick question. This is the project that was itemized showing the different projected amount of units that's going to be created and available for these postal addresses? Or was that a different?
Mr. Pischko?
This is... help me, Councilman Johnson. It is
Bruce's Park.
Bruce's Park. The city acquired this property, and it also owns a former housing, public housing site there. And so the city is considering what to do with all of this property, and it may all be residential, or it may include some commercial, so that there is not yet a final plan for how this property will be developed. There are some environmental issues with the former Globe Iron site, and this is money to assist with the evaluation of what to do with those issues.
Okay, for the environmental issues?
Yes.
Okay, I was gonna talk about that later. Okay, and it's projected, the itemized plan?
There have been plans, but there's nothing to put your teeth into yet. I don't think you've gotten down to a...
So correct. If I may, Mr. Pischko, if you could go and look at the Broad Creek Refresh, it is a document, a master plan that several communities planned out through some time now, especially during the pandemic, and it is the people's vision. Since the Globe Iron site has been closed for years, it is heavy industrial there where my neighbors live, and the community as a whole has a bigger vision for it.
I agree with that.
Yes, ma'am. So it's the Broad Creek Refresh.
Right, I do agree with that. I was just a little confused, but it did have an itemized projected of how they would add on other type of possibly residential and commercial. It did have some commercial stuff listed, if I was reading the right thing. But I just wanted to remind the council that many of my peers, we can't just live in any type of structure. To remember that when y'all doing the beautification and the redevelopment and environmental balance of that area from the industrial, that y'all consider some of our special needs, like soundproof walls and things of that nature. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mr. Bull.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R8.
R8 is an ordinance amending the FY 2023 Annual Appropriations Ordinance Number 48751 so as to accept, appropriate, and authorize the expenditure of opioid settlement funds in the sum of up to $1,154,701 as directed by settlement agreements to provide treatment, prevention, and intervention services to reduce opioid use, disorder, and misuse of opioids.
Ms. Nicole McGill?
I would like to speak on the misuse of these type of fundings. The fact that the misclassification for the underserved population from being from it being properly recorded on our records, the type of treatment, prevention, and services. So I'm appreciative that they're giving the settlement agreement. However, I would like for it to be more controlled and regulated, or if can't be that way, at least on the back end balancing out and checking and asking for feedback from the people that actually are getting the treatment, the prevention, and the interventions. And it has to also be mindful that because people were prescribed opioids don't mean that they stuck with opioids. So I think that the opioids should be, the word means brought together with the other type of substance abuse. A lot of people, including myself, abuse substance because we were prescribed that. And then we didn't necessarily stick with the harder drug like opioids. We might have went to what's called harm reduction. So that's why we're pushing for the legalization of marijuana and also being able to get it prescribed through a dispensary so we're not getting overdosed on fentanyl and things of that nature, because it's such a hard process to get to the actual dispensaries to get your medication prescribed properly. So we have to be mindful that opioids might have been what a person was prescribed, including myself, but it's not what we stuck with, because we kind of know better. We just not capable of doing, because we're human. I currently don't have that issue, no substance abuse issues. I thank God for that. I'm in recovery. However, I still harm reduction. It still matters. And like I said, the opioids should be actually included with all the substance abuse classifications. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bull.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
R9 is an ordinance authorizing an amendment to the purchase and sale agreement between the city as seller and Newport Manor LLC as buyer.
Okay. We have several speakers. Kevin Hansen, would you like to speak, sir? Followed by Ismail Salim.
Good afternoon, members of council. I am Kelvin Hansen, president of the Hansen Company, and I'm here requesting your support of R9. R9 was necessary to correct a couple of errors that were that went over with the transfer of the property. Your support of it will actually facilitate an $11 million investment in the Park Place community, and we believe that $11 million investment will be a catalyst for additional investment to come, additional density to come, and additional density will support the Park Place Business Association's efforts to create economic vitality with the Main Street retail. So I ask for your support. Thank you.
Followed by Reverend Butler.
How y'all doing, council? My name is Ismail Salim. I live on the 700 block of Park Place, and I am going to ask for your vote and support for this amendment. I think the initial PH1 was about the parking, and that would help facilitate this amendment being approved. We have petitions. I think you all have received them earlier today. We have letters of support from religious institutions, educational institutions, the former mayor, and you all have voted unanimously for it previously, and you voted for it another time after that. I have 8 years of support for it, and I just had some support for all of my community a couple weeks ago. And I'm sure Pastor Butler will say the same thing. Just need your support so Park Place can be economically viable as we want it to be. Thank you.
Thank you. Reverend Butler.
Followed by
Columbus Grant. Good evening.
Pastor Butler, I'm passing at 500 West 28th Street in the beautiful city of Park Place. Again, thank you so much. I look around the city and I see so many positive things. And contrary to public opinion, some would still use the terminology of low income in regards to this project. And I think you're intelligent enough to read and started the project to know the difference in the workforce. Contrary to what some may believe, this will be a very, very positive. I sat not only with the Park Place Business Association, but also as a member of the Tidewater Ministers Association, and talking with the pastors Monday, they were very excited about the opportunity to put some density in the area and bring positive change. Again, this will be something that all of us can wrap our arms around. I won't prolong the hour because I see y'all strictly about business, but just know that we're still supporting it. You voted for it. Amen. Need I remind you that we had to vote to move this forward, and we just needed to get across the finish line. And I assure you again that you'll look back on this and realize that this was the starting of something really great in Park Place that we can all wrap our arms around and be proud. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mr. Grant, followed by Nicole McGill.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, staff. I'm Columbus Grant, president of the Park Place Business Association. I just want to come up here and say thank you for allowing the city attorney's office and the city manager's office to change the reverter clause to allow this project to go through. I know they had some things that had to be addressed that Virginia Housing had concerns about. And I'm just appreciative that you found it in your best judgment to address those needs. So with that being said, hopefully this will be the last hiccup we'll have with this project. It's been going on for a while. Thanks again. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Ms. Nicole McGill, followed by Alton Robinson. You pass. Mr. Robinson, followed by Latif Rashid.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I know the city council, you guys have a tough job making decisions and trying to make people happy. I know that y'all may or may not vote. This one I can't see which way you're gonna all say, I cannot say. But I would say that we need housing. There's a housing crisis, not just in the city of Norfolk, but across the whole globe, well, America that is. And this is an opportunity for the council to consider fair housing across the whole city, so it won't be no concentration of poverty anywhere. So I hope that this council would take that into consideration. I don't know the laws, but I know somebody who do know the laws and what can be done and what can't be done, and how much money we should invest and how much money we shouldn't invest. But this is a time now that we need to start investing money into the people. So that's what I have to say about that. I'm not a proponent, I'm not against this project. I'm actually for this project, really. But I'm also for fair housing. And I know you guys can do it. It hasn't been done under any council. So you guys can be the first council to take the initiative to move forward and say, we're putting together a fair housing policy. So people wouldn't have to come down here and talk to y'all about what's right, what's not right, what's not happening in my community. Because you have made it fair. You have done what's right. And I know y'all can do it. I believe you all can do it. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Latif Rashid, not here, okay. Pastor Joe McDaniel. It's Pastor McDaniel, Joe McDaniel. Mr. Jordan, Riley Jordan, would you speak, sir? You pass. Okay, Mr. Bull.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
No.
Mrs. Johnson.
No.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
No.
Mr. Smeagol.
I just want to say, I been a man of my word on this, and I'm going to vote yes, but this is it. We can't keep on kicking the can out of the road. So I really hope that this is it. We can't. This is 8 years. We got to get this project done. Let's get it done. Support the community, but we can't just keep on doing this. So I'm going to vote for it so that we can move it forward, but this is it, okay? Please, it's not a threat. I'm just telling you, I put my word out there last year that I was going to support this. I'm going to do it now, but it's tough to keep on extending this because we don't do this for everybody. And so we're, you know, this is it. So aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Yeah.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Ms. Clark, R10?
R10 is an ordinance granting conditional use permits to authorize the operation of a convenience store for the sale of smoking products named Evans Grab and Go on property located at 3409 Chesapeake Boulevard. And by a vote of 5-1, the Planning Commission recommends denial.
Vanessa Evans, followed by Charles Brooks. Vanessa Evans?
Charles Brooks.
All right. Mr. Brooks, come on. Is Ms. Evans here? Okay.
Is it Mr. Evans or Ms. Evans?
If Vanessa Evans, followed by Charles Brooks.
Right.
Good evening, Council. Thank you for hearing me out. Is it Vanessa Evans? And I am the person that's trying to open the business. And first, I would just like to say thank you for hearing me. And second, as a Black woman trying to become an entrepreneur, I already felt that sometimes the odds would be against me. Trying to start this business has been one of the most cumbersome processes ever. I always prided the Mermaid City of being the city of economic growth and prosperity, which is one of the reasons I elected to purchase my home here, which has been over 25 years. I've also had This is the reason I wanted to start my business here. However, this current experience has led me to believe being a small business owner is a thing of the past here in the city of Norfolk. This new CUP process is, in my experience, is built on one's opinion and not facts, as well as a who's who. I say opinion as I was told by planning that I'm in a school district. However, the school district is 11 blocks away from me. If I'm in a school district, then other stores, whether grandfathered or not, are in a school district as well. This can sometimes lead to disparate treatment for new businesses. I was told there's many stores in the area, but honestly, we all bring different perspectives. In having a business, there's always competition. Can you imagine if we only had one doctor's office, one church, one beauty salon, one funeral home, one law firm, one school? We wouldn't have no diversity at all. I'm selling hair, lace fronts, which no other store in that area sells. I'm also providing fresh fruits, vegetables, along with some vegan options, bottled smoothies, packaged salads, just to name a few of the Hepsi options as well. But it seems everybody just harbor on tobacco products, which are legal, as a way to say no. Also, it was stated that we have, that in this store is saturated. But if that's the case, then why were we given the option to approve a new Royal Farms? It seems that the CUP is frowning on small businesses, but if you're a larger corporation, you get through. This CUP process, in my opinion, knocks down small business owners before even giving them a chance. For those who have had a business or even been self-employed, I'm sure it starts with a vision and someone giving you a chance. In the past, I had two stores in this district from 2004 to 2014, so the CUP process wasn't needed. I obtained this property under the idea we were under the same rules and regulations. To date, I spent $7,000 leasing the building I can't occupy due to these CUP rules. All I'm asking the council is to give me a chance to show the community and others in that neighborhood that this can work. That's all I'm asking for is a chance. And I know that this can work, and I will see to it that it works. And I'm willing to just say, let me have a temporary CUP to see if this works, to show that it can work, and move forward. We can revisit it in 6 months, revisit it in a year, revisit it whenever. All I'm asking for is a chance from council. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Brooks, Charles Brooks.
Good evening, Council. How are you? Everybody doing today? Well, Vanessa, you had a store before,
And she ran. Everything ran peaceful. It was out in Northview area. Everything went fine and everything. And Norfolk is about growth. And that's what we do. We grow. We Norfolk strong. You know, and that's one thing I believe that, you know, this council right here, y'all play it fair. Y'all play by the rules. And so like I said, just give her a chance, please. Have a great day.
Thank you. Alfred Evans, followed by Erica Jones.
Good evening.
Evening.
I'd just like to say everybody is focusing on stores, but not focusing on what the store is going to be about. It's a store that will cater to the community, to the definition of the word. A store that people would love to come to. It could set the tone for their day. It's just, everybody knows how a major store, once you go to it, you already know how the aura is gonna be. But this is a small store that will really just make a change around the neighborhood. For people, you can come there. It might set the tone for your day. For the little while that you're in there, you might leave out and feel better than when you came in there. Everybody deserves a chance. But just imagine if you was close to your chance and it's snatched away from you. Just imagine in y'all neighborhood, you can go to a store. And when you left off, you'd be like, wow, I feel good. A store where you don't even plan to go get anything. You just want to go there because of the atmosphere. A store where you can get your big cookie. But I know it's protocol and doing a lot of things. And sometimes with protocol, some people do insert their personal opinion or feelings. But if everything is done right and everything is done fairly, you just have to have an open mind. I just like to say, sometimes when you overthink, you see things that aren't there for real. And you start envisioning what you think, but the actual act is not what you think. You have to see it first. But I guess that's all I got to say. Everybody have an amazing remaining of the day.
Thank you. Erica Jones, followed by Candace King.
Good evening, Council. How are you doing? Thanks for your time and your patience. I'm speaking on behalf of Ms. Evans. I went to high school with her. She just asked for a chance. She just has her brother and her mother left, and they depend on her to take care of them. She's done very charity events and helped our community and donations and everything. So just put yourself in her shoes. Everybody's out here to take care of their families. That's all she wants to do is just get a chance to take care of families. Thank you. Have a good day.
Candace Kane. Annie Robertson. Mr. Bull?
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Ms. Evans, I want to say thank you for the conversation that we had concerning your business. And we talked about how things have changed in Norfolk. I truly respect that you once were a business area, a business owner in the Five Points greater Norview area. And yes, Norfolk does care about its small business here in the city of Norfolk, or Councilwoman Royster and I would not have spent weeks bringing in hundreds of small businesses to teach them how they can be successful, as well as teaching them how to get the money and where the money was, the millions of dollars that are there for small businesses. That's how much we care for the small businesses in the city of Norfolk. I am deeply concerned, as I expressed to you, that you signed a 3-year lease before coming to the city to find out exactly what it would take to start your small business. And that was something that we shared with the small businesses as well. We strongly encourage people not to sign leases until you are sure that you can open your business. And all of the resources are here available at the city at your fingertips. It is. We also talked about, Ms. Evans, what your vision is for the store, as well as what the vision is for the citizen in Coleman Place and Estabrook. And again, I am concerned that the community, as well as you, could not come to an agreement as far as what it could be and could look like in the community. I don't know where you stand at this point as far as your lease. I don't know. But because your vision of what the community wants is not matching up, I'm going to have to say no. But I will also encourage you, if you are interested, there are resources within the city who can help guide you through.
Ms. McClellan?
No.
Mr. Page?
I'm going to say aye, and we have to do a better job helping small businesses and the people from our community get up from the predicaments and conditions that they're in. We have to do a better job.
Ms. Royster?
No.
Mr. Smigiel?
I just wanted to point out that we have not voted on vaping in any convenience store in the last year and a half that's come before us. So vaping has been pulled on every convenience store, including the Royal Farms. They're not allowed to sell vapes as well. My issue with this is the statements that were made. I didn't see anything in here about it. Its proximity to the schools of the Sherwood Forest is down the street. Mm-hmm. It's the issue of the parking. And because it is a convenience store, the ability, the high density, high capacity use, it says in the parking layout is less than ideal for this use. So I can't support that because of the issues that could cause. So no.
Mr. Thomas?
No.
Dr. Alexander?
No.
R11 is an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize a short-term rental unit on property located at 849 34th Street. And the applicant has asked that this item be withdrawn.
Motion to withdraw R11, Mr. Bull.
Ms. Doyle.
Voting to withdraw. Aye.
Ms. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R12.
R12 is an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize short-term rental units on property located at 594 West Ocean View Avenue, and by a 5-1 vote, Planning Commission recommends approval.
Nicole Pace.
Hey, guys. Good evening.
Good evening.
Do I need to do my name and address at City Council? Okay. Nicole Pace, 1600 Granby Street. I just wanted to come up and address 594 West Ocean View. We're working with Mr. Fang, who's here with me today, to bring back this property having a permit. It previously had a conditional use permit. It was ran by a property manager, a real estate agent, who didn't seem very concerned with compliance and renewals of permits, setting dates in their calendars, things of that nature. So this property lost its permit. As soon as we found out when we went up for the renewal that the property no longer had a permit, we pulled it off the market. We've done quite a bit of work on it and actually have quite a bit of work in the works too for this permit. One of the things that if you're a Willoughby neighbor, you might really enjoy about this is with this permit, that garage, the blue garage at 594 West Ocean View is coming down. I see the shaking of the head. I agree. I cannot wait to remove that garage as well. So that is something we're hoping is really going to bring 594 and the rest of Mr. Fang's portfolio into the new aesthetic of Willoughby. That's my hope. So we've done a lot of work with the Planning Commission and the site planning. The only request I have today is originally we were going to be approved for 5 years, and then there was some concern about the permit not being issued to Sojourn, it being issued to the property owner. And I'm going to say this, and I hope that I'm saying it correctly. There's been wording with the city attorney that you all are going to be able to issue the permit to us, and that if we were to no longer work with this property owner, or we were to be let go by this property owner, that the permit would go with us. And so then there would be maybe not so great of a property manager in place of us with the permit. So, you know, Sojourn is really committed to our brand and our aesthetic and our compliance and our relationship with our neighbors. So I hope that would be in consideration. And with that, we'd like to re-request the 5 years based on the economic outlay, just the garage, the driveway, and the landscaping alone. So far, preliminary is at $29,000. This doesn't take into account the work for the deck, all of the work that he's done on the interior that he's paid us to do, we spent close to $60,000 on. So I would just like to be reconsidered for 5 years. I've talked with the Planning Commission about it, and they did encourage me to ask for that again now that we know that the permit will be with Sojourn. So that's all.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Mr. Pishko, you've heard the request to amend to 5 years.
I'll move.
That we add?
Motion.
Yeah. Yeah. So Mr. Bull, read with the with the amended 5 year language reflected in the resolution.
Is the motion to extend it from 2 to 5
in the motion
and require that Sojourn be the operator? Is that
the permit is the yes, permit is in their name.
So let me make sure the applicant is okay with Mr. Flynn.
That's the one I was confused about.
Yeah.
The permit is for the property, and it's not in Sojourn's or the owner's name. It runs with the property.
The applicant is Mr. Ben Toefling.
Yes, sir.
You're the owner and the applicant?
Yes, I am. This is my first time attending such a meeting. Thank you for your time. Consider my application. As Nicole mentioned before, previously the manager, he's a licensed realtor, but he's not, doesn't have expertise to manage the short-term rentals, which is highly regulated. So but now I have Sojourn, which is a top-notch, like very high-caliber provider for hosting. So the license will be under Sojourn's name. So Sojourn has a sizable portfolio and impeccable reputation to protect. So I hope you guys will consider this fact and extend the permit to 5 years.
So Mr. Bull or Mr. Pishko, is Sojourn the applicant or Mr. Fling the applicant? Who's the license is going to be issued in whose name?
It will be for the benefit of the property. The only CUPs that we issue in individuals' names are for the sale of alcoholic beverages, and these are not individual-specific. It's for the property.
Got it. Okay.
So what you're saying is that there hasn't been anything from the city attorney's office that says that the permit can be granted to the operator, not the property owner.
But what we did say is that if the council wanted to make it a condition of a short-term rental, they could require a particular operator. They could require professional operation.
Right. Okay.
So if you wanted to add that as a condition, you could.
So the condition would be that if he terminates that operation agreement with Sojourn, then he automatically loses the license. So we're putting that condition in. So the motion is to add the condition in that it has to be Sojourn and extend it to 5 years.
That's what I was trying to ask.
Gotcha.
Just make sure the applicant, sir, yes. Is this what you're requesting?
Yeah, I'm totally fine with that. Yes.
You're requesting the proposed language. Okay, thank you, sir.
Ms. Pace, do you have a 5-year agreement with Mr. Fang, or you're going to get that 5-year agreement after this vote? Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Yeah. All right, Mr. Bull.
So the motion is to add Sojourn
and five years.
With the condition of 5 years.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
I'm going to support the city's lead and say no.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
Okay. All right, excuse me, and that was for 5 years, correct?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Bull,
R13. R13 is an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize short-term rental units on property located at 1282 West Ocean View Avenue, and the City Planning Commission unanimously recommended denial by a 6-0 vote.
Okay. All right. Ms. Pace, Nicole Pace.
Okay, thanks for having me back again. So for this one, I wanted to address the Planning Commission, which was, there was some contention that Mr. Fang was not with me at the Planning Commission, and they wanted to hear from him and his commitment to making things right, having the right property manager in place, and working with the community to do the right thing. So that is, he was out of town at the last meeting. I've spoken with the planning people about it. We were gonna withdraw, but Russell encouraged me to come and talk this through and bring Mr. Fang with me. There's a lot of, we also had a neighbor who was really concerned about parking, which this conditional use permit completely covers. I wanna address, I'm not sure if those comments are up here, but I personally went to the site this weekend, and he's right. There are all kinds of Virginia license plates in this parking lot because it's right there on the beach. And we knew then that it was not like a tenant problem, that this parking lot is not a towing parking lot, and it is a hot spot for parking to go to the beach. So not only are we going to be doing massive improvements, which this one is well over $30,000 also, for all the new landscaping, the sidewalks, the new concrete, the stormwater, but we're also immediately going to a decal parking lot so that we can control what's going on back in that parking lot, because I personally went to go see what was going on this weekend. I was like, yeah, this is 6 or 7 locals, right, hanging out at the beach, and I understand why, because it's really hard to park in Ocean View and not get towed, right? So if you can find a building that doesn't have the A1 towing sign on it. So I'd like a chance at reconsideration. The motion, well, my ask is also to reconsider for the 5 years here. This one's going to be a much bigger economic outlay and a much longer project. And the same with the condition, now that I know the wording, that Sojourn is the operator of the property. And we are operating the entire complex. We've done a lot of work out there. We've removed the dumpster on West Ocean View. We've gotten new trash cans out. We've got all new landscaping going in at the front, even though that's not part of 1282, because I want Sojourn to be a part of the great aesthetic of Willoughby. And so it's really important to me that the entire complex is improved, not just 1282.
Mr. Pishko, so Planning Commission, I see Paula and Susan Pollock back there. You've said a lot, but the Planning Commission voted 6-0 to recommend denial of this application.
Yes.
We have that in front of us.
What
you're proposing, we do not have in front of us to consider. However, you know, if the owner of the property, again, must agree to what you are considering, and and then we can certainly consider it. This is different from the previous application.
I understand, right?
Much, much different.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just wanted to kind of preface, like, the reason behind it was that he needed to be here with me to talk about the concerns of him as a previous operator. So we're here to do that today.
So I'm inclined to send this back to the Planning Commission. I mean, I think, you know, this probably needs to go back and Mr. Thomas.
My concern is there have been changes since I was at the Civic League meeting when you presented, and they voted in favor. And so
yes.
Which was odd. Planning voted against it.
Right. I agree. But there are some significant changes that you're bringing forward now today that I'm not necessarily against, but Civic League's not aware of it. Planning Commission's not aware of it. So it would be helpful to maybe have them opine. Maybe can you go back and talk to them about these changes? I mean, there's a big difference between 5 years and 2 years that you're asking for that
absolutely, yeah,
would change my vote, I think. So I think going back and seeking...
Can I ask if the Civic League is meeting anymore this summer? I know East Ocean View, I think, is adjourned. Which I understand why.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know if
you're not sure. Okay.
Mr. Mayor, would it make more sense to continue it generally to allow for what you're asking, as opposed to doing a complete withdrawal, so you don't have to get through that process?
I would be open to just continuing it and going back to planning.
I think we can refer it back to planning by vote. You don't have to.
Motions to re-refer. Mr. Bull.
Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. Mr. Bull.
R14. Certainly. The first ordinance amending and reordaining the FY24 compensation plan ordinance and its attachments incorporated herein by reference so as to provide for the possibility of general wage increases as necessary, notwithstanding the maximum salaries authorized for each city position by council by amending sections 2 and 3 of the compensation plan ordinance and section 1 of the compensation plan regulations, and so as to correct a clerical error in Plan 2 by amending Exhibit E of the ordinance containing pay plans 1 and 2. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Do we ask him to reread that?
Exactly the same way.
I couldn't do it. Thank you. Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R15.
Aye. Yes, I have an ordinance providing employees an additional day of holiday leave on Monday, July the 3rd, 2023. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Enjoy. Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
For those who didn't hear, this is a vote to give the employees off on July 3rd as a holiday, which wasn't originally on there. So aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye. R16.
R16 is an ordinance appointing Patrick Roberts as city manager. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
I'm going to vote aye. Pat, you're going to do a great job, but I do want to comment on how disappointed I am in how this process has played out. Say what you will about Dr. Filer. I think he's done a great job, and in many ways, I want to commend him for the work that he did with the Coastal Storm Risk Management Plan, which is going to be, I think, one of the most substantive projects that we will ever have that will protect the city of Norfolk. I am concerned, after having just come through much of the citizens' uproar about how we hired the Norfolk police chief without having enough transparency, and here we are right back at it. And I am concerned that this has become a habit, and we've got to get past this. I want Pat to be successful. We have a council manager form of government. What does that mean? That means that the city manager is essentially the CEO of the city. He or she at times runs the city in the day-to-day. We, as the council and the mayor, act as the board of directors of the city. We need to support him, allow him to do his job, and recognize that there are eight of us who support him. Not one, not two, but eight. I want to make that very clear as well. I hope, and I've said this the last two meetings, and this is going to something I'm say every time, we as a council need to have a strategic planning session. We need to enumerate what our priorities are and provide that to the city manager. That is what we owe you so you can do a good job. And I hope that we will be able to do that soon. I vote aye.
Mr. Page?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Yeah, just real quick, I want to thank the city manager, Chip Filer, for the work that he did while he was our city manager to steer us through the pandemic the way that he did economically and to still maintain the bond ratings that we did. I just really want to commend him. And also just personally, of all the city managers that have I've worked with, he was the first city manager to recognize parts of East Ocean View that looked like third world country with its infrastructure and to actually find the money and invest that in East Ocean View. He was committed to neighborhoods, and I appreciated that work as well. And I do believe that Mr. Roberts is going to do an outstanding job in continuing the work for the city, listening to our constituents, listening to us. And your resume is impeccable. I think you are going to do a great job for us. So, aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
That's all I have to know.
New business? Before we begin new business, Mr. Bull, can you please read the rules governing new business?
Certainly. City Council rules permit each speaker 3 minutes to speak on new business. As you approach the council, you'll notice a timer on the lectern. At the beginning of your 3 minutes, a green light will activate. 2.5 minutes into your remarks, you'll notice a yellow light, indicating you have 30 seconds to finish your comments. At the end of 3 minutes, you will see a red light and hear a beep. We ask that you conclude your comments at that time. While speakers have an opportunity to address council on new business, all comments should be made in a manner that respects the seriousness of the forum and should not be made in a profane, disrupted, sarcastic, or demeaning fashion. All remarks shall be directed to the City Council as a body rather than to any particular member of City Council, staff, or the audience. A speaker who fails to comply with the basic rules of decorum will be deemed out of order and not allowed to conclude his or her comments.
Thank you. Fred Gallup. Fred, it's good to see you.
Mayor Alexander, Council, thanks for the opportunity to be here. I got a special award to make tonight. Ms. Mamie Johnson, Councilwoman Johnson, has been part of the Coleman Place Esterbrook family. She's always there for us. She's never too busy. And I would like to present this award to her for being there for us. Since my wife passed away, I have gotten into the Diamond Art program. And I did an eagle. And I said to myself, you know, this is an eagle. It's the national bird. Why not make it an award? So, without further ado, I'll show it to you.
Oh my goodness.
Very nice, Fred.
Put her up.
I'd like to present this to Ms. Mamie Johnson for a job well done and for being part of the family of Coleman Place Esterbrook Civic League.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Mamie. Yeah.
Mr.
That's nice work,
Fred. Mr. Fred. And to the Coleman Place Esterbrook community, I just wanted to say thank you. Esterbrook was one of the first communities when I first got elected that demanded that I meet with them under any circumstances. And Ms. Aurelia, I think you remember Ms. Susan Tweet, she called three times, and Aurelia tried her best to convince the Estabrook family that she couldn't promise. The Estabrook family met on the second Tuesday, which is a council night, and their words were, I don't care what time she gets out of the council meeting, we want her at the meeting. And so I honored that request at 8:30 p.m. that evening, and Ms. Susan Tweed made it, who's passed away, made it clear that no matter what time I got out, they just wanted to spend a little time with their newly elected council person and just to have refreshments and desserts. So at 8:45 p.m., that's what we did at Estabrook, and then Estabrook decided that they would change their meeting date so that I could meet with them at any time. So I just want to say thank you, and to all of the Civic Leagues in Ward 3, and to all of the citizens. You're only a phone call away or email. That if I can help you in any way, I'm more than willing to help you. So thank you, Mr. Fred.
Thank you. I would also like to say, Ms. Dole, I know your husband for many a year, so if you'll please tell him I said hello. And thank each one of y'all for the job that you do. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. Joe Hamm. Joe's followed by Nicole McGill.
Council members, my friends and neighbors in Park Place, good evening.
Good evening.
Would my friends please stand? I'm here representing, I'm the vice president of the Park Place Civic League, representing our group. We're a unified group. I reside at the 700 block of West 37th Street. I moved here about 5 years ago, and I love my neighborhood, and I'm happy to be contributing and carrying the torch forward in some way. Our vision in Park Place is to have a safe, healthy, diverse, and inclusive neighborhood of choice. Environmentally, this is sustainable as well. So our vision and our success is possible because of actively engaged residents. Business owners from all walks of life, young and old, new and established, of many colors, many creeds, we're coming together to understand and support one another in our shared goal. The Park Place Civic League is requesting your support for city funding of the Park Place Visioning and Engagement process or plan, Refresh. Through a special collaboration between our neighborhood and our Ward 2 and 7 representatives over a decade ago, starting in 2009, the Park Place received city funding to support, to engage a consultant team to develop with a partnership with residents for a healthy neighborhood strategy. The vision and engagement plan strategy resulted in a significant advancement for our neighborhood in Park Place. There are a growing mix of long-time residents, new residents like myself, businesses, neighborhood neighbors, all working to manage the day-to-day outcomes of the neighborhood. An update to the strategy will result in growth for our neighborhood, evidence-based thinking, development and health for the Park Place neighborhood, while also strengthening our future neighbor-to-neighborhood ownership of our community. The Broad Creek Refresh Project, as was referenced earlier, demonstrates the value of updating neighborhood plans and strategies to current conditions. It's time to take action now. It's time for us to do this refresh and keep things moving. We recommend at least $200,000 in support of the VEP refresh, and we request the opportunity to co-develop language for an RFP as well as participate on the consultant selection team as was successfully done before. Thank you for your continued support of the Park Place neighborhood as a diverse, healthy, and inclusive neighborhood of choice. Thank you.
Thank you. Nicole McGill, followed by Carl Poole.
Thank you. My subject matter is environmental quality control concern with suggestions. This actually is something I'm bringing forth to honor my daughter, Nicole S. McGill. Today is her birthday, and the last time that we got to spend together, her career goals at only 2 years old, trust me, she was more than a handful, was to be a doctor and the president of the United States. So as a mother that did homeschooling, more so with my special needs and her underdevelopment of me having to have her premature, she was very ambitious and dedicated to her schoolwork and did workshops at the library from baby garden teens to toddler 1-3 to a learning center in Berkeley to actually going to a gifted school. She actually made it into a gifted school. She did all that in less than a year, that growth and ability to attend school with five-year-olds and up. So as we walked through the community, because part of the homeschooling curriculum was for her to learn about the infrastructure of the city, from also being acquainted and a volunteer at the local libraries for their promotions to draw more students, more pupils of her age group and a little bit older, as she did some mentoring workshops as well, with the 2-3-year-olds learning how to use their words versus being overstimulated with their emotions and using their hands. So she participated with the city person that was assigned to help with that for her peer to peer facilitating them learning from her and her being younger, actually. So I would like to pass some of these concerns that she actually pointed out to me. These are recent actual photos. But again, me and her did these exploring curriculums about 3.5-4 years ago. So this is why this is really concerning for me to bring this to subject today. In honor of her birthday, is because these things are not getting any better. The trees aren't getting any younger. They're getting older, and we really need attention to these trees. And also the poles that are made up of the wood with the supporting of the steel or the iron or whatever materials they use to help support them, because they are hazards to the city. They are falling down. They are falling into other trees. We have new development houses that were built up next to these lots with neglected trees. And also, one of the signs in Ocean View 9th Street entrance, you have the parallel with two arrows. You need to think about a new type of sign. And there are those four examples. Thank you.
Carl Poole, followed by Monet Johnson.
Good evening, Council, and let me be the first to come up here and say it. Congratulations, Mr. Roberts. My name is Carl Poole. I live at 1049 West 49th Street. A lot of times I come up here, I'm really critical. Tonight, that's not what I'm here for. I am here to say thank you. I want to thank you for any part that you played in working with the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority into considering and now following through on installing, at least testing out, emergency call towers in public housing, specifically in Calvert Square. They just recently announced that sometime by the end of the summer, they will be installing and testing a call tower out there. And if they get positive results using that call tower, that it'll be considered something that they want to use in every public housing development in Norfolk. This is community-centered innovation. I know when you look at the news coverage, you see things like using license plate readers throughout the city to better innovate when considering how to improve public safety. But a community-centered approach gives people a voice. And I want to thank all of you for continuing to give more people a voice in Norfolk when it comes to their safety. This is something that is, you know, this is call and response. When people call for something and you do it, this is what they want to see. This is what is needed. This is what is best when it comes to responding to community need. And I want to thank you all for any part that you played in that. Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Monet Johnson, followed by Javon Bennett.
Monet Johnson, Argonne Avenue. I am also here to say thank you, surprisingly, because I know that the Call Tower pilot program couldn't have just happened within the confines of the NRHA alone. I'm up here a lot, and I'm tough, but I have to give credit where credit is due, and I really appreciate any work that you all have put into creating this pilot program. I appreciate a lot of things. I appreciate this, and I appreciate a plan that's fireproof. So sometimes we bring ideas. It's like, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? And it just lets us know that what we're bringing forward has been tested by you all, y'all's experience of being on council, and that knowing that our plan has made it through that series of tests is something that I can also appreciate, despite how it feels when we're doing the fire testing. So that's it. I just want to say thank you. And I'm even smiling, which is rare. For an occasion, I hope the camera's on me. But thank you all, and I will see y'all on the 11th and not the 18th, because y'all canceled that, and I appreciate it, because I can, like, do something else. Have a good one, y'all.
Javon Bennett.
Hey, how everybody's doing? I love you to death, Andrea, but I'm glad Chip is gone. I know. I'm sorry. I'm not going to continue with him. Yeah. That's all I wanted to say. I'm just glad he's gone. Oh, Mr. Roberts, I'm glad that you're in your seat. I appreciate your, from what I'm hearing and with our research, et cetera, et cetera. You're a man of your word. Very transparent. You listen, and you're receptive to what people are saying. So. Congratulations on your job. So I just want to talk about something I was writing earlier, a synopsis for something else. But I just want to point something out. We've been talking about food deserts lately, and something I just wrote down, I just figured I'd say it. Food deserts affect children the most. Nutrition can impact everything from a child's growth to their mood, behavior, and learning capabilities. Food regulates blood sugar, that balances out hormones, that control mood and ability to concentrate. So I'm saying that to say this, a lot of children are acted out in schools, and one of the reasons can be and is food, a lack of food. About 80% of the children who act out during the day is because they didn't eat breakfast. I know from personal experience, when I guess there was like a lack of AP tests and IB tests or whatever, so we all had to actually take the SOL test, which we was done in like done in like 5 minutes or whatever. But they actually fed us before we took a test. Like, we never got fed before doing a test. So if the scholars know food can translate to your brain functioning better, then everybody should know that. So I was doing a lot of research with the food, and of course y'all know, as long as everybody does in Norfolk, about the lack of a grocery store in St. Paul's area. Now, I do know from conversations, not just with a couple of you, other people, research on my own, that this is not like the city can take over the grocery store. You can, but it's not y'all thing. I understand that. What I'm asking for is, when we get this thing up and running and get investors and people who's interested in actually trying to build a community store, and we can ensure safety, ensure that there'll be security there and not as much stuff, et cetera, that the city will be along with us in the fight to combat this food desert. You know, we just can't just let this just go away. We understand that the city cannot actually build the grocery store and run it, but we do ask for support, and I hope that all of y'all will be able to at least consider being helping hands with this project. Y'all along with Miss Pope and Mr. Price back there, they had very, very intelligent people, and I would like them in on this project as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, just...
Yes, Mr. Smigel.
With the grocery store, because we had some conversation after the last meeting, you know, good opportunity to go back to what Ms. Johnson was saying. We denied Ms. Evans on her grab-and-go convenience store, but she spoke of fresh fruit and salads and things. Maybe this is an opportunity to help her re-envision and putting a small grocery store in St. Paul's with support from the city and getting the folks. She's left, so I don't know if there's anybody here with her party anymore, but I think, you know, Mr. Washington, we've all said that we would love to have a grocery store there. We know that it's difficult right now to get grocery stores to agree to go anywhere, but maybe this is an opportunity to help her with that modeling and kind of do the same type of organic growing of a grocery store in an area that's needed and something that we can support because through grants, helping her get out of the lease that she's in so that she can save that money, but then helping her channel through and putting a grocery store in there, even if it's a small one, no, something to get started without vapes and smoking. But just, you know, something that provides, and maybe she needs that guidance and help. Just an idea to throw out there since we brought it up earlier.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yep. That is exactly that. Okay. We could make some concessions and help guide her through, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I also just wanted to say, because I think lack of knowledge as far as running a grocery store is kind of something that a lot of people don't know. So we just come up here, food desert. There's a lot of things that go into it, actually running and actually getting people to actually, you know, fund the grocery store and contribute with it. But I know as a whole, as a city, we all can work together and try to figure something out.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Elise Peterson McMath.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name's Elise McMath. I work off West 25th Street. I also wanted to thank the council for any efforts that they may have put forth in convincing the NRHA to go through with the pilot program for the call towers. I personally think it's a step in the right direction. I think that impoverished neighborhoods are oftentimes over-policed, which contribute to a cycle of poverty that's hard to break because over-policing contributes to the mass incarceration, especially in Norfolk, but also around the country. And that being said, I think community-based initiatives are good because there's an aspect of consent, whereas I think there's been a non-consensual component to the idea of installing more cameras and the idea of license plate readers. And yeah, I love that they're piloting this program. I hope that they might also consider piloting future programs. Maybe you all could help lead those initiatives with Norfolk Public Schools. I know there's a need for wraparound services in schools in these neighborhoods as well. So hopefully there's room for collaboration in the future. And thank you.
Thank you. Tiara Lassiter. Tiara Lassiter, followed by Alton Robinson.
Tiara Lassiter, Sewell's Point Road. So I believe in giving flowers too when it's due. So thank you to the council for assisting us with our call towers. And special thanks to Mr. Page for always listening to our ideas and being willing to see things from a different perspective, especially given the fact that what used to work for yesterday does not work currently in today's society. Looking forward to seeing more progression, more collaboration, more transparency, more open and honest communication. Looking forward to seeing more good things that bring about positivity and empowerment in Norfolk. So I'm just kind of thankful that things seem to be going in the direction of progression and change rather than continuing the same broken generational cycles. Looking forward to being able to collaborate with you guys on other projects like affordable housing, any of the other you know, severe needs that we may need in the city. Y'all know what these needs are by now through much advocation. Looking forward to working and collaborating with the council, the communities, and all of the organizations who really want to help see Norfolk be stable, thriving, and actually a better, like, city than what we've seen it in years. Looking forward to the day where crimes will be decreased and we see less death on the news. Looking forward to where we can actually continue to value one another and find value in one another as people versus, you know, what it is we do as far as our jobs or our political stance. So I think that you guys helping us with the call towers was extremely well. I think it sets a good standard. I think it sets the tone. I think that it definitely gave impoverished people in those communities hope and encouragement that we can actually fight for something and get it. I think that it is actually a good thing whenever underimpoverished neighborhoods are now getting attention and people are starting to have conversations about their actual needs. So I'm definitely appreciative of actually feeling like I was heard after all these times of coming here. So I do believe in giving the flowers. So thank you.
Alton Robinson.
Hey, Alton, you gotta be nice. Hey, now everybody else has been.
Tell you something. Hey, let me share this. I know that the mayor runs this council, right? But I declare this day, thank you, Council Day. This the first time I've been here, and all I've heard was thank you, Council. Thank you, Council. Thank you. And then here I come over here to say thank you, Council. First of all, I want to say that Chip Fowler, at one time I did say you need to go. But then time went on, I really got to know him. And then right when I'm getting to really know him as a person, he know me as a person, he's gone. But that's okay. You know why? Because Pat is in the seat. And I know that Pat will do the city well, and he'll do all you guys well. And like I said before, all this council need to do, y'all got the power. All y'all need to do is work together. Just work together to make. Look, y'all got a smart man over there, Mr. Pisco. Very smart. Now you have Pat Roberts. And now all of you, the council, all we got to do is work together, see what the people want, see what the people need, and whatever the people want and what they need that you can do without breaking the laws of the city, let's do it. Let's do it and get this city rolling so that every other city around the city, like Virginia Beach, y'all say, what are they doing in Norfolk? They don't have no more crime. The people are getting to get the jobs. The entrepreneurs are growing. Businesses are growing. We can do it. And I say we because I want to be a part of it. So I'm just sharing that with you all. I want to thank you guys. Y'all got me down here happy. I mean, I'm really happy. Then when y'all say Pat, man, and then Chip Fowler told me, go see Pat. You remember the last meeting I was in? Go talk to Pat. And I came and talked to Pat. So Pat, now that you're the city manager, Am I still able to, you know, because I remember you're going to show me about the book. I'm going to come see my man. See, already. That's what we got. That's what we need. So I know elections coming around. So all y'all coming around, we want to keep you. Everybody going to be reelected. Everybody going to be reelected. Don't worry about nothing. And now we just work together because we don't want to change the council, get new people. So anybody got an election coming up, we're going to vote for you. Okay? Long as you keep the same thing going, because we want the city moving forward and the people in the city moving forward, and then everybody come together and won't have no concentration of poverty over here. We'll have everybody on the same playing field, level, like that. I'm a builder, so I know about level. So thank you.
Thank you.
Pat, you take care, man. And y'all work with Pat. Pat going to work Pat going to work with the community, and y'all work with Pat.
Thank you.
All right.
That's all been recorded.
Janice Taylor. Is Janice Taylor here?
I think she can make it.
She can make it. Janice Taylor. Mr. Bull, do you have another?
Nothing else, sir.
Mr. Pisco, do you have another?
I do not, thank you.
Mr. Roberts, do you have something to say, sir?
Yes, sir, thank you.
Smart man.
Smart man.
go home.
All right.